지피지기면 백전불태. 적을 알고 나를 알면 100번 싸워도 위태롭지 않습니다. 이제 막 주식시장에 뛰어든 분들이 나에 대해 성찰하고 시장을 보는 눈을 기르길 원하는 김한진, 윤지호, 김동완의 투자 원칙과 인사이트를 공유합니다. 주식시장에서 헤매고 있을 주린이들을 걱정하는 저 김프로의 어드바이스. 주식의 시대, 투자의 자세에서 확인하세요. 전국 서점과 온라인에서 만나보실 수 있습니다.
산업을 이해하고 기업을 이해해야 돈의 흐름이 보입니다. 리서치명가 메리츠증권과 3프로TV가 함께 야심차게 준비한 3프로TV 주식대학 겨울학기 실전투자특강. 남보다 한 발 앞서서 유망한 산업을 판단하고 1등 종목을 선정하는 투자의 기본기를 다지는 시간이 될 겁니다. 국내 최고의 애널리스트 21명과 함께 떠나는 2021년 성공 투자를 위한 단 하나의 필수 코스. 지금 바로 신청하세요. 자세한 사항은 페이지 2 공지사항을 확인하세요.
리얼 리스크 포 오펙 플러스. But Joe Biden and Iran are going to add 1.8 million barrels a day. Everyone will realize we do not have enough supply later this decade for that. I'm sure as an economist you understand is wrong. We are in danger now.
글로벌 모니터스 세 번째 시간. 로버트 맥널리, 약칭으로 밥 맥널리입니다. 조지 W. 부시 행정부 시절 백악관에서 미국의 에너지와 에너지 관련 대외 정책을 주관했던 보좌관입니다. 그리고 백악관을 나와서는 아주 그 전문가들 사이에서 가장 높이 평가받고 있는 책을 썼습니다. 그 책 제목은 좀 책 제목이 긴데요. 원유 가격의 급등락, 부제는 석유 가격 급등락의 역사와 미래입니다. 왜 석유 가격이 춤을 추는지 그거에 대한 역사적 맥락을 바탕으로 역사적 경험과 맥락을 바탕으로 미래를 조망한 책입니다. 제가 개인적으로는 사실은 그 로버트 맥널리는 몇 차례 인터뷰를 한 적이 있습니다. 전화로 들을 때마다 그의 구조적인 설명, 역사적인 설명 그리고 가장 현실적인 돈의 흐름을 바탕으로 한 단기적인 설명을 아우르는 전문가 가운데 한 명으로 한 명이라는 느낌을 받았습니다. 자, 그러면은 이제부터 로버트 맥널리, 밥 맥널리, 미국의 에너지 컨설팅 회사 래피던 대표의 인터뷰를 시작하겠습니다.
우선 그 작년에 원유 시장이 상당히 큰 충격을 받았습니다. 올해는 뭐 경기가 회복되면서 반등할 수 있을지 좀 주목이 되고 있는데요. 올해 전망은 뭐 어떻게 보고 있고 또 시장은 언제 완전히 회복할 수 있을까요?
Expectation for the oil market improved since yesterday because Saudi Arabia succeeded at surprising the world by giving what it calls a gift to the oil industry in the form of a 1 million barrel a day cut in production alone by Saudi Arabia. This was completely unexpected by market participants. And it means that the oversupply or the glut of oil that has developed in the world because of COVID will go down faster. So before the Saudi cut, we were expecting oil prices this year to range around $45, later $50 a barrel. But because of the Saudi cut, We have updated our numbers, and we think oil prices will now be in the low $50 range this year. So the outlook improved because Saudi Arabia decided to reaffirm its role as the leading swing producer in global oil markets. When I make a forecast, I always ask, how am I wrong? Because the only thing we know about anybody's forecast in the oil market is that it's wrong. No one is perfect. And then we ask ourselves, is it more likely that prices go lower or more likely that prices go higher than our forecast? In Rapidan Energy Group's view, the risk to our forecast is lower, at least in the first half of this year. Demand weakness, especially in Europe, not so much in Asia. Asia is coming out of the COVID crisis better than Europe. And Europe, and to some degree the United States, are reimposing lockdowns, and demand will suffer. So there is danger, especially in the first half of the year, due to COVID. Before the vaccines are fully available later this year, there will be a risk of lower demand. Secondly, we believe that President-elect Joe Biden will allow Iran's oil exports to return much faster than the oil market expects. And while this is assumed in our base case forecast, we think this will be a surprise to many traders and investors. And Iran's return, plus Libya's resilience and return, will put pressure on OPEC Plus. So the risk to our $50, $55 oil price is lower.
네, 바벨 말 중에서 이 스윙 프로듀서라는 말이 나왔는데요. 스윙 프로듀서가 뭘까요?
오펙은 한마디로 말하면 원유 생산자들의 그 카르텔입니다. 카르텔이 유지되기 위해서는 조정자가 필요합니다. 그걸 이제 이른바 스윙 프로듀서라고 이제 영어로는 표현하는데 그 조정자 역할을 한 나라가 사우디아라비아였습니다. 1990년대 사우디아라비아가 생산 내지는 감산 쿼터 이상 이하로 생산량을 줄이거나 늘리거나 해서 원유 가격의 급등락을 막아왔죠. 그런데 그 역할을 포기했을 때에 국제 원유 시장은 가격이 폭락했습니다. 그게 1990년대 중반 일입니다. 밥, 과거에 나와 인터뷰할 때 사우디하고 러시아의 동맹을 신성동맹이라고 표현을 했습니다. 양국의 신성 동맹이 어떻게 지금까지 잘 유지되고 있는 것 같습니다. 그리고 앞으로 어떻게 될 것 같습니까?
The Russian-Saudi marriage or holy alliance could be a Netflix series. It is full of drama. The highest moments of joy and happiness and success, as we saw yesterday, and we saw in 2016. When they agreed to get married and begin cooperating. But also, as we saw last March, enormous tragedy, anger, and problems and collapse. When they didn't get along in March of last year, and I was at the OPEC meeting, OPEC Plus meeting, and I went to Riyadh afterwards, when they split, oil prices, as we saw, collapsed. So it has been a rocky road for the OPEC Plus alliance led by the Holy Alliance of Saudi Arabia and Russia. But you know, in the history of the oil market and in recent history and today, we see one thing over and over again. Producers of oil fear price collapses. They fear it terribly. We saw that last year. So this fear creates a will to cooperate. And You know, there's an old song in the United States, Love Will Keep Us Together. It's a Captain and Tennille, very famous when I was a boy in the 70s. But I would say with OPEC Plus, it's Fear Will Keep Us Together, meaning the fear of a price collapse hurting all producers will likely keep the producers engaged in the marriage, engaged in the alliance, and cooperating on supply cuts.
신성동맹. 뭔가 그 의미 자체가 굉장히 뭐 신성한 느낌이 든다.
그렇죠.
이런 생각이 들긴 하는데요. 왜 특히 사우디와 러시아의 결합을 신성동맹이라고 표현을 했을까요?
맥널리 이 사람의 전공이 국제관계 정치학입니다. 그 정치학을 하는 사람에게 익숙한 그 신성 로마 제국이라는 말이 있습니다. 누가 비아냥거렸죠. 이름만큼 신성하지도 않았고 이름만큼 강하지도 않았고 그래서 영미권 사람들에게 특히 서양 사람들에게 신성 동맹이라는 것은 상당히 깨지기 쉬운 아주 그 결항 껍데기 같은 그런 약속 동맹을 말할 때 신성 동맹이라고 말을 하곤 하거든요. 그래서 러시아와 사우디아라비아가 OPEC 플러스를 만들었지 않습니까? 2016년경부터 이제 그 체제가 유지되고 있는데 그거에 대해서 이르는 말로 이 석유 수입국들이 저건 언제 깨질지 모르겠다. 언제든지 깨질 수 있다라는 그 희망 내지는 그 역사적 경험을 바탕으로 신성동맹이라고 낮춰 부르는 말입니다.
아, 언제 깨질지 모르겠다. 제가 생각했던 그런 의미와는 좀 다른
다르죠.
것 같습니다.
예.
상당히 네, 다르네요. 그렇다면 이 방금 밥의 이야기 중에 두려움이 양국을 함께하게 만든다 이렇게 표현을 했습니다. 신성동맹이라는 그 의미 자체도 쉽게 깨진다는 것을 의미하는데 언제까지 이 두려움을 기반으로 한 협력이 지속될 것으로 보고 계시나요?
I think for the foreseeable future, for the next year or two, until the oil market exits this glut, this bust phase in prices, they will stay together. Here's the real risk for OPEC Plus. And it's seen also in history. Previous swing producer groups, like the Texas Railroad Commission and US, which was the swing producer from 1930s to 1970s. And then OPEC, from the 1980s until about 15 years ago. When they really get into trouble is not so much in the busts, but the booms in oil prices. So I think the most difficult moment for OPEC Plus will be when the oil market begins to boom again, when demand recovers from COVID, and when it responds to these lower oil prices. And then when the consequences of low investment in supply, so investment is collapsing in the oil market, falling 30% a year. This means there will be less supply in the future. These two factors should push oil prices up. The Texas Railroad Commission ultimately failed in a boom. It did not have enough extra oil capacity to put on the market to stop oil prices from rising. And in 2008, OPEC, not OPEC Plus, OPEC failed to stop the price boom that went to $143 a barrel. Again, demand was running faster than the production capacity they had. So my prediction is, the bigger likelihood is later this decade, 2026, 2027, we will get into a boom phase in oil prices. We will run out of available production capacity in the near term. This will cause an oil price boom well into the $100 range. And this is when OPEC Plus will have its biggest challenge.
그 맥널리 설명 가운데서 아주 독특한 아주 낯선 그 위원회 이름이 나왔습니다. 텍사스 철도 위원회. 여기 대해서 간단하게 설명을 한다라면은 20세기 초반 미국이 이제 원유를 개발하지 않습니까? 채굴을 하는데 텍사스 지역의 생산자들이 그 과잉 경쟁에 의해서 이 원유 가격이 폭락을 합니다. 그때 이제 그때 당시에는 지금처럼 파이프라인이 많이 발전하지 않아서 철도가 원유를 주로 수송을 했는데 그 텍사스 철도 위원회가 과잉 생산을 막기 위해서 생산량을 그 회사별로 쿼터를 정해 줬습니다. 이건 사실 철도 위원회는 그 과잉 경쟁을 막기 위한 공급 쇼크를 막기 위한 정부 주정부의 기구입니다. 여기 사실은 오펙의 전신입니다. 오펙이 이 텍사스 철도 위원회 철도 위원회의 모델을 벤치마킹해서 오펙을 만들었습니다. 네 번째 질문입니다. 바이든 행정부의 에너지 정책이 미국의 셰일 업계에 어떤 영향을 미칠까요? 사실은 그 바이든은 기후변화 협약에 다시 가입하는 등 친환경 정책을 쓸 것으로 알려져 있습니다. 사실 그 미국의 셰일 업계는 트럼프 행정부 시절에 떼돈을 벌었습니다. 바이든 행정부 시절에도 비슷한 어떤 횡재 떼돈을 벌 수 있을까요?
Also, my view, Nam, has changed or has been adjusted since yesterday because the other big event, aside from the OPEC Plus meeting, was the election in the state of Georgia for two senators. It appears the Democrats won both seats. This means Joe Biden will enjoy a Democratic Senate as well as House. So the Democrats will have full control of the government. Biden will be restrained to some degree by, let's say, moderate or relatively pro-oil and gas Democrats. When it comes to taxation, taxes are likely to go up on the industry, and regulatory cost is going up. So I do not believe that shale oil and shale gas can have a bonanza under the Biden administration because the cost of capital, regulatory burden, and now taxes, given yesterday's Senate result, are likely to go up. However, by lifting oil prices as they did yesterday, OPEC Plus, we think later this year, in the third and fourth quarter, especially of 2021, shale oil production will come back a little bit. We think as much as by 600,000 barrels a day at the end of this year. So let's put it this way. Shale oil will get a little bit of help from what the Saudis did yesterday, but they won't have a bonanza because of the increasing cost and regulation due to the Biden administration. Final point, just 4 years ago, the Obama-Biden administration was arguably pro-shale oil and pro-shale gas, especially natural gas. It did not heavily regulate it. It allowed the United States to export oil and gas, which we do to South Korea, as well as other countries in Asia. The Democratic Party has moved in the last 4 years far away from support for oil and gas. So this is perhaps the biggest challenge for shale oil producers in the next 2 to 4 years, is the shift in the Democratic Party away from oil, but also natural gas. So no bonanza, I'm afraid, but they will be helped a little bit. They'll have a nice meal, a good dessert from the OPEC Plus, but no bonanza.
유가 전망치에 대한 의견이 분분하긴 한데 올 하반기에 $60를 돌파할 수 있을 것으로 좀 예상을 하고 계신지요?
Nobody can predict the price precisely, and having studied oil markets for 30 years, the only thing I've learned very, very firmly is to be humble when you predict. However, our base case suggests we won't get to $60 a barrel this year unless we have a geopolitical disruption. The risk here is mainly with Iran. And so that's a risk. We think there's maybe a 1 in 5 chance, 1 in 5, so only 20%, but not small, that Iran will cross the line and settle scores with the United States and Israel for the assassinations that have occurred recently of senior Iranian officials, attacks on its nuclear program, and this could lead to a military conflict. More likely, with Joe Biden, there will be a return to the nuclear deal and a resumed Iranian exports. And it's because of those resumed Iranian exports. Remember, up to 1.8 million barrels a day of new supply. So Saudi Arabia just cut by 1 million barrels a day. But Joe Biden and Iran are going to add 1.8 million barrels a day. That new supply, plus Libya. Libya is now at 1.2 million barrels a day. And so far, both sides seem to be making enough political progress and benefiting from oil sales that we think 1.2 million barrels a day will stay for the time being. So this extra supply plus the demand weakness, especially in the first half, I think is going to keep oil prices in the $50 range and prevent them from rising to the $60 range this year. But again, later on this decade, we go back into the hundreds, I believe.
제가 이건 좀 오래전부터 궁금했던 부분인데요. 이 대체 에너지가 개발이 되면서 수요가 다른 쪽으로 쏠려서 원유 시장이 예전 같지 않을 것이라고 보는 사람들이 좀 많습니다. 장기적으로 봤을 때에도 원유 시장이 이전만큼 건재할 걸로 예상을 하고 계시나요?
Great question. Thank you for that question. That's a great question. Let me start by saying, since the oil market began this third era of extreme volatility, about 2005 to 2008, we've had a huge surprise about every 5 years. And the past surprises were on the supply side. It was the failure of producers outside of OPEC to raise production relative to consensus in 2003, 4, 5, and 6, which helped create that boom. And then it was the shale oil revolution in 2010 to 2011, 12, which was the next big surprise. And then in 2014, Saudi Arabia said, we will not cut without Russia. This was a surprise. Nobody expected this. So the last three big surprises came on the supply side for oil. In my view, to answer your question, the next big surprise will come on demand side. The consensus, I always say, remember, everybody's forecast is wrong, including the consensus. So I ask as an analyst, I say, where is the consensus wrong? In my view, the consensus is too optimistic about the electric vehicle penetration and energy transition in transportation for this decade. Longer term, I think it is likely we will find other forms of transportation fuel, whether it's electricity or hydrogen generated from various sources. I know in Asia, there's a lot of interest in hydrogen, as in Europe. So longer term, I don't deny that we will find alternative and cleaner ways to transport ourselves. However, in this decade, it won't be as fast. Let me use some numbers for you. Let's talk a little bit about numbers. Okay. If you look at the oil forecasts of leading forecasters for this decade, from between now and 2030, from the International Energy Agency, from OPEC, from other leading forecasters such as private oil companies, BP, Equinor, etc. What you see is the forecasted demand for oil is well below a million barrels a day, or well below 1% a year. 400,000 barrels a day, 500,000, 600,000 barrels a day. So well below 1% a year. This is very low because they assume healthy GDP growth. Typically, oil demand grows at about half the rate of global GDP. So in the past, and we've seen this in history, if world GDP is going to be about 3%, oil demand typically, conventionally, in the past, most people would forecast about 1.5% oil demand. In a 100 million barrel a day oil market today, that means 1.5 million barrels a day. That's three times faster than the 0.5 or 0.6 or 0.7 currently forecasted. So why? Why are the forecasters assuming such a low rate of oil demand? It's because of what you mentioned, because they believe that policymakers, especially in China, the United States, and Europe, but also South Korea is a big producer, especially and consumer of electric vehicles, will push electricity into the transportation fuel. Now, we may wish this to happen for environmental reasons and so forth, for climate change. But as an analyst, I have to say, how likely is this? How likely is it? And when we analyze the policies and the consumer preferences we see around the world, we are not convinced that they will be as successful this decade as forecasters assume. Let's start with China. China's the big deal for electric vehicles. They are by far the biggest producer and consumer buyer of electric vehicles. But China has found they're costly. And since 2019, the middle of 2019, they have cut subsidies for electric vehicle purchases. That plus COVID has caused electric vehicle sales to fall sharply. Now they are returning to about 1.1, 1.2 million units, but they have gone flat in the last couple of years. And China, if you look at the actual policies, in our view, is unlikely to subsidize and push electric vehicles as fast as would be needed to justify those oil forecasts. Now we look at the United States. The United States, under Joe Biden and a Democratic Senate, it's likely there will be more subsidies for electric vehicles, and they will pick up to some degree. However, the sales have peaked at the end of 2018. The electric vehicle sales are still only a small fraction of the total vehicle sales in the United States. Consumers prefer trucks, SUVs, and gasoline-powered vehicles. There are still big consumer concerns in China and the United States, especially about range, about refueling time, et cetera. Now, in Europe, we see much stronger policy. But if you look, whereas Europe had been subsidizing the purchase of electric vehicles right now and taxing oil, it has been shifting to mandates on producers to stop making them in 2030 or 2035. And we see there's a lower willingness to take the budget cost of pushing these electric vehicles. So, you know, I as a student of politics, okay, one thing you learn is, above all, politicians like to get elected. This is what they really want to do. Or in China, they want to stay in power. And to do that, you can't push your consumers and pressure your producers too hard. You get protests and you get pushback. In South Korea or Europe or the United States, you can lose an election. In China, worse things can happen. So when we look around the world at protests over fuel price increases and subsidy cuts, we notice governments are more likely to slow down. Take France. France was going to impose a carbon tax. This caused massive protests in France, and the government had to withdraw the policy. Take Iran, where recently subsidies for oil were removed, prices went up. And this triggered the biggest protests in 40 years. They killed 200 people. Here's my favorite anecdote for this. 2019's climate change talks, the COP talks, Conference of the Parties talks, were supposed to be in Santiago, Chile, you may recall. But at the last minute, they had to be moved from Santiago, Chile to Madrid, Spain. Why? It became unsafe in Santiago, Chile due to massive protests. What caused the massive protests that required the climate change talks to be moved from Santiago to Madrid? A fuel price increase, 4% for subway fares. So when we look objectively at the willingness and the ability of national leaders to impose large costs on their consumers, which are necessary to push EVs because of consumer preferences for gasoline and diesel vehicles, we find that despite some very optimistic talk and promises to ban things in the future, we see that the reality is not as positive as the rhetoric. As they say in Texas, if I can use a beef analogy, there's more sizzle than steak, you know, more thunder than rain, okay? More talk than action. This is something we observe. So I think oil demand this year, this decade, is going to be 2 to 3 times faster than the consensus. If I'm right, everyone will realize we do not have enough supply later this decade for that. We are killing supply. And this is what will cause the next boom, in my view.
지금 전 세계적으로 유휴 생산 능력이 급격히 줄어들어 있는 것으로 알고 있습니다. 만약에 원유 수요가 코로나 이후에 빠르게 늘어난다라면은 그 원유 생산국들이 적절하게 대응해 줄 수 있을까요?
When we think about oil prices and the risks of especially a boom in prices, we have to ask ourselves how much spare capacity is needed to be reasonably reassured that if the market gets tight, let's say I'm right about oil demand being faster, that producers can prevent what we saw in the 1960s, the 1970s, or 2003 to 2008, a price boom. Now, there is no science here. It's only an estimate. But my research and my book concluded that, especially if you look at the 1990s, which is a good example of a relatively calm period in oil markets, the middle of the 1990s, about 5% of total oil market demand or production should be kept in spare capacity if we want to be reasonably confident that oil price stability can be maintained. Now, in a 100 million barrel a day, and I think growing market, that means 5 million barrels a day. Now, currently, we have more than 5 million barrels a day, much more, because Saudi Arabia, Russia, UAE, Kuwait, they've cut production because of COVID. They've cut. So currently, we are okay. But because I think the market is going to tighten later this decade, demand will outstrip net supply growth. That spare capacity cushion will go down. And I think well below 5 million barrels a day, well below 2.5 million barrels a day, and then eventually disappear. And this is mainly because of inadequate investment outside of OPEC, and I think this demand shock. But you know, Anam, even if you set aside my view about stronger oil demand and say, well, let's just look at the IEA and others. If you look at the IEA's forecast, even the IEA sees a smaller spare capacity later this decade. And this is often overlooked. People sometimes think, oh, electric vehicles are coming. Oil demand is going to peak and then die. This means oil prices will never go high again. We will never ever see $80 a barrel, $90 a barrel, $100, never, because of electric vehicles. This, as I'm sure as an economist you understand, is wrong. Even if oil demand peaks and electric vehicles are everywhere, supply for oil can fall faster than demand. And if supply falls faster than demand, if investment falls faster, then you can still have a price boom even though you're having a demand peak. And the IEA in its forecast, which is much more optimistic about electric vehicles, much more, even it sees a what we call a rising call on OPEC. And that implies downward pressure on spare production capacity. I just see a much tighter spare capacity than the IEA, but even they see that.
유유 생산 능력, spare capacity of production이라는 말을 쓰셨는데 아마 즉시 원유 생산이 가능한 유전이라고 볼 수 있겠는데요.
오히려 이 spare capacity보다 유휴 생산 능력이라는 단어가 더 어려운 것
그렇죠.
같아요.
우리나라 말이 더 어려울 때가 있습니다.
네, 유휴 생산 능력.
네, 발음하기도 힘들어요.
뭘까요, 이게?
유전을 탐사, 시추, 그다음에 본격적인 생산 이런 정도의 과정을 거쳐서 유전이 하나의 이제 개발이 되는 거죠. 근데 이 유휴 생산 능력이라는 것은 개발은 완료되어 있기 때문에 언제든지 국제 유가가 올라간다 하면은 이미 개발돼 있어 원유 채굴을 언제든지 할 수 있는 유전 정도 지금 현재 한 250만 배럴 정도가 추가로 더 생산 가능합니다. 예.
그러면은 유가가 언제부터 본격적으로 상승할까요?
I think we will see stability in the $50 range this year. And then, hopefully, if COVID gets behind us, I think by the middle of the decade, you'll start to see 60, 70, and then toward the end of the decade, a boom towards well above $100 a barrel. So I think we have to wait at least a year to, as we say in our expression, get out of the woods, get out of danger. We are in danger now because of this huge inventory overhang, which still exists, and these uncertainties about vaccines and so forth. And so, and the pace of demand recovery, and uncertainties about electric vehicles. I could be wrong. It's entirely possible. As my wife will say, I make many mistakes, so I could be wrong. If oil demand falls, faster than I expect, the COVID weakness response endures, we could see lower for longer. But as long as OPEC plus the marriage, the Russian-Saudi Holy Alliance, exists and is strong, we should avoid returns to $30 or $20 or $10 a barrel. And I think we have a floor around $40 to $50 a barrel. And then later this decade, we should rise well toward $100 a barrel, if not over.
맥널리는 올해 국제 유가를 $50 선으로 보고 있습니다. 물론 최근에 급격하게 반등해서 $50 선을 넘어섰습니다. 최근 $53, $4 그 정도 선에서 오르내리고 있습니다. 단 장기적으로 올해 연말까지를 봤을 때의 그 $50 선. 다만 맥널리의 전체적인 그 전망은 코로나 사태가 진정된 이후에는 배럴당 60에서 $70 선까지 갈 수 있을 것이라고 예상을 했습니다. 흥미로운 것은 2020년대가 끝나는 즈음에서는 배럴당 $100를 다시 넘어설 수 있다는 전망을 내놓았습니다. 이것은 지금 현재 많은 사람들이 생각하는 전기차의 효과가 기대만큼 크지 않을 것이라는 전제하에서 하는 예상입니다. 이것은 일반적인 원유 전문가, 원유 시장 투자 전략가들과 시각이 다른 맥널리만의 시각입니다. 의견입니다. 많은 참고를 하시길 바랍니다. 네, 수고하셨습니다. 감사합니다.